Hey guys, what's up, Rowan here from Tech Guides, and welcome to my ultimate Ubuntu server installation and setup tutorial series. Over the course of the next few videos, I'm gonna show you everything you need to know in order to set up your own home server. We're gonna start off with how to install Ubuntu on a new machine, then I'm gonna show you everything you need to know in order to actually secure your home server. This is a very important topic. Then I'm going to also talk about how to install ZFS and a RAID volume on your server, how to create your own private cloud using Nextcloud, how to get your own wiki using Confluence, your project management tool with Jira, and finally I'll also discuss how to install and set up the best password manager in my opinion. And if you're watching this video sometime in the future, then I'll have left links to each of these video topics in the description below. Now in today's first video, I'm gonna walk you through the basics of how to set up and install Ubuntu 20.04 long-term support on any machine of your liking. I will show you what kind of BIOS settings I like to change, how to burn the Ubuntu ISO on a USB drive, walk you through each of the installation steps of Ubuntu 20.04, then I'm gonna show you how to access your home server from Windows, and what kind of tools I would recommend to install right after installing Ubuntu 20.04. As always, you can find timestamps to each topic in the description below. Also, if you'd rather like to follow along this tutorial in a written form, then definitely check out my blog, where I have this entire video written down for you guys to follow along. And with that, let's jump right into the first part on how to install an Ubuntu home server. For this, first download Ubuntu by going to Google and type in Ubuntu 20.04, click on the first result, and download the server install image. Once downloaded, we need to burn the ISO to a USB stick. For this, I'm gonna use a tool called Rufus, which you can find on the rufus.ie. Download and run the tool, and then plug in the USB drive that you wanna use to install Linux with. Make sure that you don't have any important data on that drive, as this process is going to wipe all data from the USB drive. Select the proper device in the drop-down menu, and make sure that the boot selection is on disk or ISO image. Next, click on the Select button and select the Ubuntu 20.04 ISO. If you want to, you can give it a custom volume label, but you don't really need to change any of the other options. Simply click on Start. On this pop-up, select Yes, make sure that Write in ISO image mode is selected and click on OK, and confirm that all data will be wiped upon proceeding. Once you have your bootable Ubuntu USB stick, it's time to adjust some of the BIOS settings for your new home server. Obviously, where exactly you can find the settings in your specific BIOS is going to vary highly depending on the motherboard manufacturer and also on the motherboard version that you have. So if you don't find some of these options, then simply consult your motherboard's manual. After turning on the server for the first time, you should always check if all memory is correctly recognized. Here you can also see whether the motherboard correctly recognized your CPU. Also, go to the hardware monitor and check whether the CPU temperature is in a reasonable range. Here, you can generally also set up the fan curves for the CPU and your chassis fans. I personally like to set up my fans off my server such that it doesn't get too hot, but at the same time also doesn't get too loud. Also, if you don't have a dedicated graphics card installed in your system, then you should also check if the primary graphics adapter is set to onboard rather than PCIe. In this example, you can find this under the Northbridge configuration. Also, I like to set my servers up such that when the power is cut, it will simply boot back on as soon as power is reinstated. And the final option that I usually check is whether the server is able to wake on LAN. And with that, we're ready to plug the USB stick into our new home server. Back in the BIOS, make sure that under the boot menu, your USB stick is the first boot option rather than one of the other drives that you have in your home server. And once everything is ready and set up, reboot your computer and start the Ubuntu 20.04 installation procedure. First, we can select which kind of language we want to use. Obviously, we're going to select English. And then we also ask whether we want to update the installer. Now, since we want to install the 20.04 long-term support version on this home server, I would highly recommend not to update on this screen. Here, you can specify your keyboard layout, and since I'm Swiss, I have to change this to Switzerland. Now under the network configuration, you should see your primary internet adapter and whether it has received a valid IP address from your router. By using the arrow keys, you can navigate to your primary internet adapter, and if you want to, you can also change the IPv4 method. However, at this stage, I would simply recommend to use DHCP instead of manually entering the IP address. The next page allows you to set up a proxy address, but in most circumstances, you simply want to skip this option. Here, you can specify another Ubuntu Archive mirror, but generally you want to leave this at the default. Now for this tutorial, I'm going to be using an entire disk to install Linux on. Now make sure that you actually select the proper drive for your operating system. If you want to, you could also add this to an LVM group, but I generally like to set up my hard drives after I've installed Linux. Go to the next page where you can now see a file system summary of your storage configuration. As you can see, I've set up the Samsung 840 NVMe as my operating drive. On this page, you could also set up a RAID or LVM, but I prefer to set up these kind of things only after I've installed Linux. So make sure that everything looks exactly like on screen right here. Click on Done and accept that the hard drive will be formatted. Next, we want to enter a username as well as the server's name. In my case, I'm going to call this server Kirill and use Roman both as my name and as my username. Here, you should also enter a rather strong password. Next, you can select if you want to install the SSH client. Now, this is a means of accessing your home server from the outside world. Generally, if you want to be able to administrate your Linux server from another computer, then you should install the OpenSSH server. And finally, on this page, you're asked if you want to install snap environments. Now, snaps are basically self-contained images of software that come with their own Apache or Nginx servers and are extremely easy to run and maintain. Now, I used to be a big fan of snap, but honestly, you can basically install anything that you can install with snap in the regular way, and it's usually much more stable and you can customize the software much more to your liking, and therefore I do not like to install snaps anymore on my server. Once the installer is done, let it download and install security updates and hit reboot. Now, once Ubuntu is installed, don't forget to unplug your USB stick from your server, because otherwise you're simply gonna go into an infinite loop of installing Ubuntu over and over again. So after a quick reboot, you should now be able to log in to your home server using the username and password that you provided during the installation. Next, I'm gonna show you how to access your home server even from the outside world using SSH. First, you're gonna have to forward a port in order to access your home server from the outside world. Usually, this is done in the router configuration. In my case, I have a Fritzbox and this is located behind 192.168.178.1. If you don't know the standard gateway for your router, you can simply flip it around and generally there will be a sticker on your router informing you how to access the router configuration. Also, if you don't know the username and password, this is also where you usually find it. First, make sure that the router always assigns the same IP address to your home server. You can generally find this under the Network tab. Here, you sometimes also find the option to allow wake on LAN. Next, go to Permit Access and forward port 22 to your home server. This is only going to be necessary if you want to access your home server from a different network. Now, I will be discussing security concerns of using port 22 for your home server in another video. If this is already live, then I have it linked in the card right now. Now, in order to access our home server from Windows, I generally like to use the WSL or the Windows subsystem for Linux coming with Windows 10. Reason being is that with WSL, it is super easy to access our new home server from Windows. Now, I'm not going to show you how to install WSL on your Windows machine. If you're interested in that, then definitely check out the video linked in the card right now where I cover that topic. Also, there is going to be a new version of the WSL coming to Windows in one of the future updates. And when this has happened, then I'll replace the video that I showed before in the card and discuss how to install WSL version 2 on Windows 10. Now, in order to access my Linux subsystem, I like to use the Windows terminal. This is basically a much improved and nicer version of the old command prompt. To install the Windows terminal, go to the Microsoft Store, search for Windows Terminal, and there you can install it. Once installed, click on the drop-down menu and click on Settings. First, make sure that the default profile is for Ubuntu. Also, you can change the color scheme of your terminal, and there's an entire website of predefined Microsoft color themes. In my case, I like to use the one-half dark color theme. And with that, let's discuss how we can now access our home server. Now, I prefer to set up an alias in the bash rc file. You can edit this file by typing in cd and then typing in nano.bashrc. To set up an alias for quick connection to your server, simply type in alias, then a random name, the username of your home server, and the local IP address. Now, you can simply enter the name that you gave your alias and the connection to the server will be established. Type yes to accept the fingerprint and enter your Linux password. And there you go, you're successfully connected to your own home server. Now, the first thing you definitely want to do is update your server. So type in sudo apt update. What this will do is that it simply downloads the package information from the internet for all of the repositories that you've got set up. Next, type sudo apt upgrade to install the updates. Now, something else that I generally like to do after I've installed Ubuntu 20.04 is to completely remove the Snappy environment. This because Snappy always comes with these dev loop file systems that kind of clutter up the system. To completely remove snap, type in sudo snap list and remove all snaps. In my case, I first remove LXD, followed by core 18, and finally snapd. Then you can completely remove snap by typing in sudo apt purge snapd. Finally, don't forget to remove the snap home from the system. And if you type dfh, you can see that the file systems now look much cleaner. And finally, I want to show you a few tools that I found very useful in order to monitor your home server. First, in order to get temperature readings from your server, you have to install LM sensors. Once you've installed LM sensors, you can type sensors to check if the system already recognizes all of your temperature couples. In my case, I can only see my core temperatures, and therefore I'm gonna have to identify all my sensors. This is done by typing in sudo sensors-detect. Answer Y on each of these questions. Type yes to add the modules. And restart your server by typing in sudo reboot now. And with that, you should now be able to see much more information regarding both the temperatures, the voltages, as well as the fan speeds of your system. In order to additionally monitor your hard drive temperatures, type in sudo apt install hdd temp. In order to figure out the temperatures of a specific hard drive, type in sudo fdisk-l, and now type in sudo hd temp followed by the hard drive identifier. Note that if you enter this for an NVMe SSD, you're not getting a temperature reading from it. However, I'm getting nice temperatures for all of my other Seagate hard drives. Finally, to monitor my server, I also like to use a tool called Glances. You can get this by typing in sudo apt install glances. This tool gives you a nice overview of how much CPU you're currently using, how much memory is committed, which disks are being written to or read from, how much data is passing through your Ethernet adapter, and which kind of processes are currently active. And with that, your new home server is up and running and you're ready to install software. Now, as I've discussed before, in the following videos, I'm gonna show you how to format and partition hard drives, how to secure a server, and how to install a bunch of software. If you're interested in that, then definitely consider subscribing. If you liked this video, leave a like. If you didn't, leave a dislike. Thank you guys so much for watching. Have a wonderful day, and I'll see you guys in the next video.